Who is the greatest African in history? By greatest, we mean which African achieved the most out of every other African? Which African left the greatest legacy, had more influence, and contributed more to the world than every other African? Is it Nelson Mandela, Thomas Sankara, Kwame Nkrumah, or who? Let us find out now. I am Eze Chimere Nwauzo. I'm an author of The Wisdom and the Power of African Unity, author of 202 Questions and Answers About African Progress. I'm the leader of One Africa Family OAF, and our vision is to lead Africans from last to first. Let us start with Nelson Mandela. Nelson Mandela was born 18th of July 1918, and he ruled South Africa from 1994 to 1999. Nelson Mandela is best known for being in jail for 27 years, from the 7th of November 1962 to the 11th of February 1990. He stayed in jail 27 years. Because of that, most people acknowledge him as being the greatest African because he has made a sacrifice that no other African or no other leader in history has made. Also, Nelson Mandela ruled for only a single tenure in South Africa, in a continent where most African leaders want to rule forever. Also, Nelson Mandela was the first black president of South Africa, and he received over 260 awards in his lifetime, most notably the 1993 Nobel Peace Prize Award he won with F.W. de Klerk. Nelson Mandela in 1996 also kickstarted the Kick Out Polio Out of Africa, and by the year 2020, the World Health Organization certified that Africa had become free from polio. He was truly a great African. Let's talk about Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. Dr. Kwame Nkrumah began to rule Ghana from the year 1951 to the year 1966. He was the first Prime Minister of Ghana, and Dr. Kwame Nkrumah is known to be the greatest advocate of African unity. He advocated for African unity more than any other African in history. He is the founding father of the Organization of African Unity, which was formed on the 25th of May 1963. But Kwame Nkrumah wanted more than that. He wanted the United States of Africa and championed the cause so vehemently and so strongly, but was resisted by fellow African leaders. His independence, or the independence he got for Ghana in the year 1957, got many Africans their own independence because it inspired many Africans to gain their independence by the year 1960. Kwame Nkrumah is the author of several books like Dark Days in Ghana, New Colonialism, Last Stage of Imperialism, the autobiography of Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. He is known to be the greatest threat to new colonialism in Africa. He is also known to contribute to peace and security in Africa. For example, the Katanga crisis in Congo, he sent his troops to bring peace in Congo. Because of all these and many more, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah was voted in the year 2000 by BBC listeners as the greatest African in the past 1,000 years. What about Barack Obama? Is he the greatest African? Barack Obama is known to be the first black president of the United States of America, and he was sworn in on 20th of January 2009. Barack Obama, we expected much from him, but unfortunately, we do not see his footprints on the African continent. Instead, he killed Muammar Gaddafi, who had so much plans for the people of Africa. Because of that, nobody counts him as anything serious in Africa, because even when we expected him to promote African unity and peace in Africa, he was busy promoting gay marriage, which we do not need in Africa. Let's talk about Muammar Gaddafi. Muammar Gaddafi is known to be among the greatest African leaders, at least in modern times. Muammar Gaddafi was among the best presidents of his time, and the per capita income of Libya during his presidency was the highest in Africa at about $11,000, compared to about $2,000 in the African continent generally. Muammar Gaddafi built the Gaddafi Man-Made River project, which cost about $30 billion, and he didn't collect even a single loan from any country to build that. Gaddafi contributed so much to African unity and was championing the cause of the United States of Africa, just like Dr. Kwame Nkrumah before he was killed. He brought out about 344 tons of gold for the African gold currency, billions of dollars to build an African Monetary Fund to replace the IMF, African Central Bank in Abuja, Nigeria, and an African Investment Bank in Libya. Gaddafi contributed $300 million to give Africa her first satellite, which Africa got by year 2007. Gaddafi did so much in Africa, invested in peace and security in many African states. He also supported Nelson Mandela when he was in prison, which was one of the reasons why Nelson Mandela had to visit him when he was out of prison. He is indeed one of the greatest Africans in history. What about Thomas Sankara, the president of Burkina Faso from the year 1983 to 1987? He renamed the country from Upper Volta to Burkina Faso, meaning land of the upright people. Thomson Kra identified with his people. He refused to use air conditioner in his office because most of his people could not afford it. He planted at least 10 million trees in his one group village, one groove policy to combat desertification in Burkina Faso. Within 4 years, his country achieved food sufficiency. He never took any loan and he refused to collect aid. He said, "Whoever feeds you controls you." So he was an embodiment of self-reliance, which is one of the things that is missing in African leadership and in the African people today. He is indeed one of the greatest Africans, at least in modern time. What about Marcus Garvey? Marcus Garvey is known to be the man who had the largest amount of followership in African history. In fact, his organization, which he formed in the year 1914, had at least 5 million members by the year 1921. Marcus Garvey taught Africans self-reliance, he fought for African independence, and he wrote to the League of Nations, which was the prelude to the United Nations, and he was telling them to grant Africa her independence. It was his activities that began to inspire many Africans, including Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, to champion the independence of African states. Marcus Garvey gave us the ROBG flag, which we use till today: red, black, and green. Red, for the blood of the African people shed for her liberation. Black, as a symbol of the color of the African man, which is a symbol of glory. And green, for the great wealth of the African continent. Also, the black star found in the flag of Ghana was taken from the Black Star Line shipping company owned by Marcus Garvey. He indeed is one of the greatest Africans in history, undisputedly. Let's talk about 14th century kings in Africa. Mansa Abubakar II and Mansa Musa. Mansa Abubakar II was the predecessor of Mansa Musa. He is one of the richest kings in history. He left his kingdom Mali in the year 1311 with at least 3,000 boats in search of the land in South America. According to the book that came before Columbus, written by Professor Evan Van Settima, a scholar in African studies, he arrived in the year 1311 AD and the Aztecs welcomed him as Quetzalcoatl, the sun god of the Aztecs. When he left Mali, he handed over to his brother Mansa Musa, who in history is recorded to be the richest man ever. Are they not among the greatest Africans? Of course, they should be. What about 15th century king who also ruled to the 16th century by the name Muhammad Askir, who was the king of the Songhai Empire? His kingdom is the largest in the history of West Africa and among the largest in the history of Africa. He is known to be an astute ruler and administrator, and indeed, he is one of the greatest men that's ever lived in the history of the world, known as Askir the Great. What about Hannibal, the great warrior, who is known to be the father of military strategy, the father of military maneuver, the greatest tormentor of the Roman Empire, who almost conquered the Roman Empire? In fact, in the year 216 BC, at the Battle of Cannae, he defeated the Romans so soundly, slaughtered at least 50,000 soldiers of the Roman Empire and lost only 10,000. After that, the Romans were so terrified that they could not face him in battle for the next 14 years. It took somebody who took his own maneuvers and skills by the name Publius Scipio Cornelius to defeat him in the year 202 BC at the Battle of Zama. Because he was so trickish, he had so much wisdom and so much intelligence that nobody could confront him. He almost defeated the Roman Empire after the Battle of Cannae, but because the Carthaginian generals refused to send reinforcements, he could not invade Rome after losing so much men when he crossed the Alps and lost so many men in the Battle of Cannae. Generals like Napoleon the Great and Hitler and so on, they all studied his maneuvers to know how to win wars. In fact, if you want to rank the greatest generals in history, you must rank Hannibal the African, and then you must rank Genghis Khan, the great king of the Mongolia Empire. He is indeed one of the greatest Africans and one of the greatest leaders in world history. Now, what about the pharaohs of Egypt? If you want to talk about the greatest Africans, the first people you should even talk about are the pharaohs of Egypt. Let's talk about the pharaohs of Egypt. Now, let's go to the pharaoh of the third dynasty by the name Pharaoh Djoser. Pharaoh Djoser built the first pyramid in history, which is the pyramid of Saqqara, known as the Step Pyramid. that is found in Saqqara, Egypt. What about pharaohs of the 4th dynasty? The first pharaoh of the 4th dynasty is known as Pharaoh of Sneferu, and that was about 4,600 years ago. Pharaoh Sneferu built three great pyramids, the Bent Pyramid, the Meidum Pyramid, and the Red Pyramid. And these pyramids are comparable in size to the Great Pyramid of Giza built by his son, Pharaoh Khufu. Is he not among the greatest people that ever lived? And the pyramids he built are still in existence in Egypt, even as I speak. Now, what about the other 4th dynasty pharaohs, Pharaohs Khufu, Khafre, and Menkaure? Pharaoh Khufu built the Great Pyramid of Giza, which is the greatest structure in the history of the world, and is still the greatest structure in the world till today. The oldest of all the 7 wonders of the world, and the only one that is still surviving up till today. Built with over 4.5 million stones, blocks, weighing like the size of a car. He is among the greatest people that ever existed on planet Earth. More than any other king you can compare in other cultures or other people or group in the world, he should be ranked among the greatest. Then Pharaoh Khafre, which if you turn his name, you get Pharaoh Africa, and Pharaoh Menkaure. These are great pharaohs who built great pyramids, which are still standing in Egypt till today. What about the pharaohs of the 18th dynasty? In fact, what about the founder of the 18th dynasty of Egypt, Pharaoh Amos I, who drove out the Hittites, who occupied northern Egypt for 200 years? He drove them out and got Egypt back into independence by liberating the northern part of Egypt, which the Hittites occupied for over 200 years. He began the 18th dynasty of Egypt, which is recorded to be among the greatest dynasties of Egypt. He built the last pyramids of Egypt and set the pace of Egypt for greater development. What about Pharaoh Thutmose III, the warrior of Egypt, who fought at least 17 wars or battles and never lost even one? He ruled the largest empire in Egyptian history, and many compare him to the biblical David because of his conquest and his fighting and not losing a single battle. What about Pharaoh Amenhotep III? A pharaoh who for 40 years had peace, just very few wars, but relatively lived in complete peace, and there was so much prosperity in Egypt when he ruled, so much that he's compared to King Solomon in the Bible. What about his son, Pharaoh Amenhotep IV, aka Akhenaten, the first king in history to declare that there's only one God, and by the name Aten. Today, Christians, Muslims, Jews believe that there's only one God, but he was the first king in history to believe that there was only one God, and that was about 3,500 years ago. Is he not among the greatest people in the world? Now, what about the pharaoh of the 19th dynasty, Pharaoh Ramses II, also known as Ramses the Great? He built more structures than any other king in the history of the world. In fact, he is the greatest builder in the history of the world. He built the Ramesseum, was part of the builders of the Temple of Karnak, built the city of Pi-Ramesses as the capital city out of Thebes, which was the capital of Egypt as of then. He built hundreds of infrastructures, statues and so on, which are still in existence in Egypt till today. He was a greater builder than Herod the Great of Judea, because these infrastructures or structures that Herod the Great built, we can't find them anywhere. But those that Ramses the Great built are still in existence in the world, even as I speak. He is known as Ramses the Great and the Great Ancestor. He is indeed one of the greatest kings in the history of the world. And he was also a warrior. He signed the first peace treaty in the history of the world with the Hittites with 158 BC. And he ruled Egypt for about 66 years, the second longest reign in Egypt after Pepi II, who ruled for about 90 years, according to some scholars, 67 years, according to some. Are these people not the greatest people in the history of the world or in African history? Yet, there are many other pharaohs and many other people who have not even talked about. I've not even talked about Imhotep, who was a vizier, who was a multi-talented genius. He was a vizier of Pharaoh Djoser, and he was actually the one that drew the architecture of the pyramid of Saqqara, the step pyramid, the first pyramid in the world, which inspired other structures in the world. The pyramid of Saqqara, the step pyramid, is known to be the first infrastructure, the first structure in the world built with stone. People from Greece, from Asia, and other parts of the world came in and saw what he built and began to copy the same pattern. That is how we now have infrastructures or pyramids in Asia, America, and so on. They all took it from Africa. This man, Imhotep, also was a physician, the first doctor in the history of the world, after being the first architect and first engineer in the history of the world. He was the first doctor in the world. And there was an article or a publication known as the Edwin Sweet Papyrus, which contained at least how to treat 40 injuries and different other ailments, believed to be written by Imhotep the Great. Imhotep was the prime minister of Pharaoh Djoser. He was a very wise man who saved Egypt from 7 years of famine. Because of the similarities he had with Joseph in the Bible, some believe that he is actually Joseph in the Bible, but it has not yet been fully proven. He is believed to be among the first person to use the papyrus and the reed. In fact, there are so many things that he did that in Egypt, he began to be worshipped as a god. He is not among the greatest people in the history of the world. He began to practice medicine 2,200 years before Hippocrates, the European Hippocrates, who they claim is the father of medicine. The father of medicine is Imhotep, the African, and not a person who lived 2,200 years after him. This man, is he not qualified to be the greatest African or the greatest man in the history of the world? But yes, he is qualified, but yet we have not talked about the greatest man in the history of the world. If we want to talk about the greatest man in the history of the world, as I said earlier, we want to talk about the person who left the greatest legacy, the greatest influence, and achieved more than every other person. And we know that ancient Egypt is the greatest kingdom in the history of the world, bar none. The most studied nation in the history of the world, gave the world mathematics, gave the world medicine, the first toothpaste, the first writing materials, gave the world medicine, they gave the world even religion, because most of the religious leaders you have in the world came to Egypt and were trained in Egypt. Moses came to Egypt. Jesus Christ, who is believed to be the Son of God, also came to Egypt. And from Christianity and Islam and Judaism came Islam. These are the three greatest religions in the world. And if you check all of them, they were influenced by Egypt. That shows that whoever founded Egypt is the greatest African in history and probably the greatest man in the history of the world. And there exists such a man. His name is Pharaoh Nama. Pharaoh Nama unified Egypt in the year 3100 BC. Some put it at 3150 BC. He unified Egypt, possibly by warfare, because in the Pharaoh Nama palette, which was discovered in the year 1898, you can see how he unified Egypt. You see where he's carrying a maze, hitting down his opponents, his enemies, and pushing them down. In another part of the picture, you see him being represented as a bull, knocking down the cities, walls of cities. Pharaoh Nama, you also see him wearing the red crown of Egypt, and at the other side, wearing the white crown of Upper Egypt, which is Southern Egypt. That is how he became the first king of Egypt, because before then, the white crown was made for the king of Southern Egypt and the red crown for the king of Northern Egypt. So he was the first person to be seen wearing the two crowns, one and the other time, wearing the other crown. Then in the Nama palette, you also see two snakes, very long snakes, almost fighting themselves, but two persons holding them back, which to me can be interpreted to mean the end of hostilities between Southern and Northern Egypt. The peace he brought between Northern and Southern Egypt, which is Egypt, is also called the land of two nations. That unity is what gave birth to every other thing that happened in Egypt. Without it, there couldn't have been Imhotep. Without it, there couldn't have been Ramses, Thutmose, Amenhotep, and so on. And even the world religions we have today probably wouldn't have been in existence without Pharaoh Nama. He was also called Menes, but Menes happens to be sort of an honorific title, a man who endures. But his name actually is believed to be Nama. He is the greatest African. The country he built is still existing even till today, and his legacy is almost forevermore. No other African can be compared to this man. And even in history, every other nation owes Pharaoh Nama, the first man to unify nations in the world, to form the first United Nations in the history of the world, the United Nations of Upper and Lower Egypt, or the United States of Lower and Upper Egypt. He is the greatest African and probably the greatest man in the history of the world. Although that can be disputed, because many Christians will say Jesus Christ, some the prophets, maybe for the Muslims and other leaders. But at least for Africans, the greatest African man in history is Naaman, even though he's not the most popular African. In Egypt, the most popular pharaoh is Pharaoh Tutankhamun, followed by Cleopatra, then third, followed by Pharaoh Ramses II, or Pharaoh Ramses the Great. But even though he's not the most popular, he actually gave us the greatest legacy, more than any other African in history. But the quest for who is the greatest African is not yet over. So long as you are here in the world, you can make the impact and become the greatest. You can make a legacy that can outlive or outshine that of Pharaoh Naaman. But until then, Pharaoh Naaman remains the greatest African in history.